الله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We mentioned in our previous class from the asbab, the means to actualize the oneness and unity of the ummah. And from it we mentioned the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through rectification and actualization of the kalima la ilaha illallah and rectifying the understanding of the kalima to tawheed, rectifying the understanding of people with regards to this kalima of la ilaha illallah, and also actualization of ittiba'ur rasul, actualizing true following of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and collecting and rectifying the understanding of sunnah through understanding the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then the ummah will be united upon that which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was upon. And we mentioned from that means also the rectification and beautification of akhlaq, of character and manners, and our ta'amul, our interaction with others. So we rectify our character and beautify it, and also the way we deal with others. Yani this is from the means of attaining oneness and attaining unity. Then also we understand that all of that which has been mentioned, it comes down to ta'atillah wa ta'atu rasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It comes down to obedience to Allah ta'ala and obedience to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in short, yani this is from the greatest aspects of bringing about unity, is that the ummah in the entirety turn to obedience to Allah and obedience to his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then also, from the means to attain that oneness and that unity, is that after obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obedience to his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in fulfilling those things which we have mentioned, that there be obedience to the wulat al-umur, that there be obedience to the Muslim rulers. This is from the greater means of unifying the ummah and uniting the ummah. That if there is a Muslim ruler, the ummah unite under obedience to this Muslim ruler. And this is in conformity with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. O you who believe, obey Allah and obey the messenger and also those in authority over you. So obey also those in authority over you. And we made clear that the ayah indicates in itself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear that the obedience to Allah ta'ala is complete and unrestricted, and the obedience to his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is complete and unrestricted, but the obedience to those in authority is only within the obedience of Allah and his Rasul. So it is restricted. Yani the ta'atu ulat al-umur, the obedience to the Muslim rulers, it is restricted to obedience to Allah and his Rasul. So as long as they do not command you with disobeying Allah or disobeying Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you obey them. But when they command you with disobedience to Allah and disobedience to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then la ta'ata li makhluq fi ma'siyatillah azza wa jal. Then there is no obedience to the creation in the disobedience of Allah the Mighty and Majestic. And so when a Muslim ruler or a Muslim authority commands you with what is obedience to Allah, says to you, Aqimu Salah, establish the Salah of Muslims, establish the Adhan, establish Jihad fi Sabilillah, establish Zakah, give the Zakah, you know, aid the poor, do all these things of obedience to Allah and obedience to His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we obey Him. We obey Him. But when the authority or the Muslim ruler tells you that, oh people, you know, we live in modern times, so it's okay that you leave the hijab. Leave the hijab from the schools. You know, like we find in some countries. Or leave the sunnah libas. You know, leave the qamis and the amaim. Why you want to do this? Shave off your beards. We say no. لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الله عز وجل. There is no obedience to the creation in the disobedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. So we don't obey them in that. And we don't listen to them with regards to that. The commands for obeying the Wulat al-Umur, yani as we mentioned now from the book of Allah Ta'ala, that Allah Ta'ala has ordered it. أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. Obey Allah and obey the Rasul and those in authority over you. So there is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to obey, yani the Muslim leaders or authority. Then also Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that when they asked him on yani the Hajjatul Wada' in the Hadith of Al-Irbab, they asked Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Awsina, advise us, counsel us. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Usikum bitaqwa Allahi azza wa jal, wa sam'i wa ta'a, wa in ta'amara alaykum abdun habashi. I advise you to fear Allah azza wa jal. I advise you to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have taqwa Allah, and as-sam'i wa ta'ah, and to listen and obey, even if an Abyssinian slave is made your leader. Even if an Abyssinian slave is made your leader, you must listen and obey. As long as the leader is a Muslim, yani you must obey him. And the Muslims must unite behind him. And this is from the greatest means of attaining unity in the Ummah. And therefore you see that the Kuffar, they are behind every call to dissension in the Muslim Ummah. Every call to revolting. Every call to khuruj. You will find the Kuffar backing it. Because they know that in this calls to revolting, there is a complete splitting and dissension within the Muslim Ummah. And that they will end up fighting one another and killing one another. And therefore they stand behind the cause to revolt. And the examples are many. In today's time, subhanAllah, the examples are all over the Arab world. In Egypt, in Syria, in Iraq. You know, everywhere in Yemen, where they got involved and incited the Muslims with revolting and revived this yani Qutubist ideology of revolution in order to bring about chaos, destroy the lands of the Muslims and have them fighting and killing one another. So this is a call that is against the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it yani it breaks apart the Ummah. And therefore the Sunnah is what Allah has commanded and what Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has commanded, to hear and to obey the Muslim ruler, even if he is an Abyssinian slave. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used this description just to show the Sahaba that no matter how unworthy you think he is of leading, whether you think, oh but he's a slave, no, oh but he's a Habashi, In one hadith, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, his head may be like the dried out raisin. Yani, to show them, you look at the person, you may think, how can this person yani, lead us? How can I obey this person? Alaykum bisam'i wa ta'ah. You must hear and you must obey. Wa in ta'amara alaykum abdun habashi. Even if it is an Abyssinian slave that is made your leader. Why? The Muslims are united in this. The Muslims, yani they will attain security, they will attain peace. Peace, contentment, safety is in this. Whereas dissension, bloodshed, fitna, splitting of the ummah is in the cause of revolting against the Muslim leaders. So therefore, from the greater means to attain unity of the ummah is to obey the Muslim leaders, as long as they are Muslims. Whether you perceive him to be unworthy or not, this is from the Yahud. Wallahi, it is from the Yahud. Where you look, where people gather together and they say, oh, but this ruler is like this and this ruler is like that. How can you lead over us? So I form a band of people, or I form a party or a group, and we call to revolting. And at the end of the day, we have Muslims killing Muslims in a Muslim land. Is this not the situation today? This is what we're living today. Because we have abandoned the command of Allah and the command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes, and why I say this is from the Yahud, remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed Talut as the ruler over them. And they're asking Allah ta'ala, Ya Allah, they go to the Prophet in Surah Al-Baqarah, and they go to the Prophet and they say, you know, إِبْعَثْ لَنَا مَلِكًا نُقَاتِلْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. They ask Allah to raise for us a leader so that we can fight in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they were suppressed, Banu Israel, they were suppressed and often they were oppressed. So they said that Allah raise for us a leader, a king, so that we can fight in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to the Prophet, إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ بَعْثَ لَكُمْ طَالُوتَ مَلِكًا. Allah Ta'ala has selected and Allah Ta'ala has sent for you Talut as your king. And what they say, أَنَّا يَكُونُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ عَلَيْنَا. How can he be the king over us? وَنَحْنُ أَحَقُّ بِالْمُلْكِ مِنْ. When we have more right to be, you know, to be the king, we have more right to the dominion than him. وَلَمْ يُؤْتَ سَعَةً مِنَ الْمَالِ. He hasn't been given any money. He's got no wealth. How can he be our king? You know, so subhanAllah, this is from the characteristics of the Yahud. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about the rule of a Muslim leader, immediately the order of Allah ta'ala is applicable to us. أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. That's applicable to us. The order of Rasulullah alaykum bisam'i wa ta'ah. You must hear and you must obey. This is applicable to us. But then when we look at it, we say, no, but he's not worthy, we are more worthy, Fulani is more worthy. And this is when the dissension happens, and this is when the fitna happens. And the hurub of fitna, the wars of fitna occur like this. When Muslims are killing Muslims, for what? For the kursi, for the chair, for the throne. Muslims are killing Muslims. Sometimes, no, but you know what? He is oppressive. He is oppressive. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَإِنْ ضَرَبَ ظَهْرَكَ وَأَخَذَ مَالَكَ. Even if he beats your back and he takes your wealth, hear and obey. There's a greater thing at stake here, and that is the unity of the Muslims. The security, the tranquility, yani of the ummah. This is at stake, not just you. Right, so this is from the means of attaining unity, is that we hear and we obey to the Muslim rulers. And not like we find this modern calls today of revolution. And they make it something great. They make it something praiseworthy. They praise the people who call to revolution. Well, revolution is not an Islamic concept. Revolution is not an Islamic concept. Allah didn't send the Anbiya and the Rusul with overthrowing the rulers. Or overthrowing even that disbelieving rulers. Allah sent the Anbiya and the Rusul with establishing his ibadah, establishing Tawheed, And when they established Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah gave them the rule. Allah gave them the kingdoms. So this is what the Muslims must realize. When we return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and establish the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this lands belong to Allah. Allah gives it to whoever He wills. Allah gives it to whoever He wills. If we rectify our position with Allah ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will restore to us, yani that authority, Allah will restore to us that izzah, which is only found in our deen. It's only found in our deen, not in revolution, not in wealth, not in dunyawi means, but in holding on to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then also, from the means of bringing about unity in the ummah, is تَرْكُ التَّعَصُّبِ تَرْكُ التَّعَصُّبِ لِأَرَاءِ الرِّجَالِ وَالْمَذَاهِبِ is to abandon fanaticism. To abandon fanaticism to the opinions of men and schools of thought. We have to be realistic about it. We want to unite the ummah. This will never occur while there is fanatical, you know, ascriptions to opinions of men. And we don't say abandon. We don't say abandon the opinions of scholars. Abandon the opinions of the imams. We say abandon what? Ta'assub. Abandon fanaticism to it. Abandon fanaticism to it. In other words, when a person, he holds or he finds the view or the opinion from an imam of the a'immah directing towards a certain action based upon the Quran and on the sunnah, and he holds on to that and he follows it, la ba's, there is no problem with that. But if a proof then is brought to him, clarifying to him that this is a mistake, and this hadith, for example, upon which this opinion is based, is da'if. And the authentic sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is something else. Then it is not permissible for him to have ta'assub, to be fanatical about the opinion that he used to follow. Rather, he now needs to follow the haqq which has come to him and which is established from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when we don't do this and when we don't abandon this ta'assub and we insist upon holding on fanatically to an opinion because it's an opinion that I held before or because it's an opinion that I know to be from the school of thought that I follow, then this is takabbur. This is takabbur, this is now arrogance. Because yani, it is as if I claim that what I am following, there is isma for it. It is infallible. It cannot be wrong. It cannot be wrong. Whereas we know that this infallibility is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah has granted it to His Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with regards to the deen. So only Allah ta'ala makes no mistakes. And when it comes to the conveyance of the deen, only our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everything he conveyed to us is the haqq. Everyone else, when we bring the opinion of any of the a'immah, yani then this is an opinion from an imam. It's an opinion from an imam. It can be right or it can be wrong. It can be right or it can be wrong. We must not be fanatical towards the opinion that I follow or the opinion that I hold. The ummah cannot be united upon that. The ummah will not be united upon fanaticism. If you know the condition 200 years ago, or more than 200 years ago, in Hijaz, in the land of the Haramain, in Mecca, in the Haram, there used to be four mihrabs. four mihrabs for the Imam of Salah. Four mihrabs. A mihrab for every madhab. And when the time of the Salah came, the Hanafis would go to their mihrab and wait for the Hanafi Imam and pray behind the Hanafi Imam. And the Shafis would go to the Shafi mihrab and wait for a Shafi'i Imam and pray behind the Shafi'i Imam. And the Hanbalis would do likewise and the Malikis would do likewise. Is this the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The adhan is made in the haram next to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they split into groups. They split into groups. One ummah. This adhan is made for all of them. Adhan is made for everyone. No, we are Malikis, we don't pray behind the Shafi'i Imam. We are Hanafis, we don't pray behind the Maliki Imam. And so forth. This was the situation in Mecca. Not too long ago. That the Ummah was split in the Haram. Upon what? Ta'asub al-Madhabi. Upon Ta'asub al-Madhabi. We had an experience once. You know, when we went traveling with a certain group. And the waqt of Fajr came. And we pulled into a place, and alhamdulillah, there were other people that was on the same journey. They also pulled into the same place. And as we prepared for salah, subhanallah, I noticed that there was a group. One side, oh, this group was moving towards one side, and they were making their sufuf. And the group that I was in, the other group, we were still busy preparing. And we were preparing on a different spot. I say to my, yani one of my teachers was with at the time, so I say, what's happening now? He says, no, it's Fajr and they are Hanafis. Okay, it's Fajr and they are Hanafis, so we can't play together. No, they don't make kunut. They're not going to make kunut in the Fajr. We are Shafis, we're going to make kunut. So subhanAllah, we're going to split and make two jama'as for the same salah at the same waqt because of kunut. No, this is not permissible. Alhamdulillah, they discussed the matter, you know, and the groups, yani the two groups came as one, and we made one Salatul Fajr. You know, but this is what Ta'assub al-Madhabi does. This is what fanatical ascription and fanatically clinging on to schools of thought, this is what it does. It splits us. It became so severe at a certain time, that in some of the books of the Ahnaf, and this is not a joke, this is a reality. In some of the books of the Ahnaf, of the Hanafis, the fanatics they wrote, it is permissible for a yani Hanafi man to marry a Shafi'i woman, but not the opposite, because they are like Ahlul Kitab. And imagine this type of fanaticism. It's permissible for a Hanafi man. Now we know in Islam it's permissible for a Muslim man to marry a woman from Ahlul Kitab. But it's not permissible for a Muslim woman to marry a man from Ahlul Kitab. This is because the leadership of the house and the lineage, it goes to the man. So now they said, you know what? The Hanafi man, he can marry a Shafi woman, but the Hanafi woman can't marry a Shafi man. Because they, the Shafi woman, they like Ahlul Kitab. Subhanallah. This is fanaticism. The worst type of fanaticism. So when there is this, how will the Ummah be united? The Ummah will never be united. The Ummah will never come together. The Ummah will never cooperate as one. Whilst there is fanaticism to the opinions of men. And we emphasize it's the opinions of men. It is not the word of Allah, it is not the word of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It is the ijtihad of a scholar, yani his understanding that he derived from the book of Allah and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So it is not infallible. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he told us that, yani إذا اجتهد الحاكم, when the حاكم makes اجتهاد and he يعني حكم, he gives the ruling وأصاب and he is correct, then he gets two rewards. He gets two rewards. If the scholar makes research and he gives a ruling and he is correct, he gets two rewards. A reward for his ijtihad and a reward for the correct ruling. And if he makes ijtihad and he gives a wrong ruling, he makes a mistake, then for him is one reward. He will get the reward for his ijtihad. But he will not be rewarded for the mistake because it's a mistake. So it should not be followed. And we cannot have fanaticism to it. It is not rewardable. Allah Ta'ala is not rewarding him for the mistake. Allah rewards him for his effort, for his ijtihad. So there can be no fanaticism to the opinions of men and to the yani to the madahib. From this also is yani how we interact with this ikhtilaf. How we interact and how we treat this ikhtilaf. What is important is that we know that the scholar who makes ijtihad, he is a Muslim who is sincere in seeking the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Quran and the Sunnah. In other words, يعني نحسن الظن بعلماء المسلمين. We have a good thought of the Muslim ulama. If an Ali makes an error, we don't immediately say, you know what? He is trying something. He is trying to bring deviation or misguidance. We give him a good thought. We have good thoughts of him because he's a scholar from the scholars of the Muslims. Right? So if the person doesn't have husnul dhan, if he doesn't have a good thought of the ulama, then he treats every error yani as a heresy, as an opposition to the Quran and the Sunnah, as an opposition to Allah and His Rasul. You know, and this also creates dissension. This creates splitting. When I have a good thought of the ulama and of the mujtahidun, then when I see an error, I deal with it in the best way. Without disrespect, without bad akhlaq and bad adab. No, like a person in today's time, when he finds that Imam Ash-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala mathalan recommended the qunut in Fajr. Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala recommended qunut in Fajr. But Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not make qunutul fajr. He did not make a qunut in every fajr salah, yani qunut of fajr. And one of the sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was asked about the qunut, and his son said to him, innaka salaita khalfa Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa Abi Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman wa Ali. But ya abati, oh my father, you prayed behind Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali. You prayed behind Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Khulafa al-Rashidin. Hal kanu yaqnutuna fil fajr? Did they make the qunut in fajr? He said, ay bunay muhdath. He said, oh my son, this is innovated. This is a sahabi. The sahabi saying, no, this is something that has been innovated. Do we as Muslims, when the view of Imam Ash-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala is mentioned to us, do we pull up our noses and puff up our chests and blow up our cheeks and say, oh, what are you talking about, Imam Shafi'i? This is no, this is su adab. This is bad etiquette. This is bad manners. Imam Ash-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala is from the A'immatul Muslimin, from the Imams of the Muslim. He is shown every ihtiram, every respect and every honor. So we say, Naam, Imam Shafi rahimahullah ta'ala, he recommended it, but it is not the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the proof that Imam Ash-Shafi rahimahullah ta'ala brought, yani this proof is not in the context of what Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did. He brought the Qunutun Nazila, and as some of the Shafi'is do, they bring the hadith that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make Qunutun Fajr till he died. And this says no, yani it's not authentic. It's not correct. So how do we treat this error? Yani with every respect and every honor to the Imam Ash-Shafi'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, but we say the majority of the ulama, the jamhur, they are correct. Those who say that there is no qunut in Fajr, that is correct. You know, so if we don't have that husnul dhan and husnul ta'amul ma'al ikhtilaf, then that will cause dissension. Because now I offend everyone. You know, whenever I come across a difference or a different view, then I offend the people who hold that view. And this is not the way of the ulama. I think many of you will know the mas'ala of Sawm Yawm Sabt, fasting on a Saturday. We know the ikhtilaf of the ulama with regards to fasting on a Saturday. And that Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala, he prohibits it in totality. Even if it is the day of Arafah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited that you fast on a Saturday, illa fima iftarada alaykum, except in that which is farad upon you. He says, even if it is a big day, even if it is yani Ashura, even if it is the day of Arafah, you don't fast on a Saturday. Other ulama, like Sheikh bin Baz, like Sheikh Uthaymeen, and yani the majority of ulama, hold the view that if it is a day of virtue, then you are allowed to fast it. Because you're not fasting it for the reason of it being Saturday, but you're fasting for the reason that it is yani Yawm Ashura, or that it is Yawm Arafah, or so, yani like this. One of the ulama of our time, Shaykh al-Allama Salih al-Suhaymi, he mentions his visit to Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala. You might know the qissa. And when he went to visit Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala, and you know Shaykh Salih al-Suhaymi is blind. And as they took him in to Shaykh al-Albani, they introduced him. And they said, you know, there is Sheikh Fulan, and Sheikh Al-Albani said, yes, I know the one who differs with me with regards to this and this. And he said, Naam Sheikh, wa ma ziltu, and I am still differing with you with regards to this mas'ala and that mas'ala. So Sheikh Al-Albani said, hakada nuridu talabat al-ilm. Like this we want the seekers of knowledge. Like this we want the seekers of knowledge. That when the haqq becomes clear to you, you hold on to it irrespective of the views of anyone else. Irrespective of those who differ with you. If the haqq becomes apparent to you and you believe that to be the haqq, then you hold on to it. Now what's that about? The sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That when the sunnah becomes clear to you, then how mustn't you hold on to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is why Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, in what is reported from him, from his statements, he said that the ummah is agreed, and the ulama, they are agreed, that man istabana lahu sunnatun ar Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that whoever a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes clear to, فَلَا يَحِلُّ لَهُ أَنْ يَدَعَى لِقَوْلِ أَحَدٍ. Then it is not permissible for him to leave it for the statement of anyone. If the sunnah becomes clear to someone, it is not permissible for him to leave it for the statement of anyone else. And this is the, يعني سبحان الله حقيقة الاتباع. Once again, the reality of following Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Everyone else we follow, yani in order to bring us the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the sunnah becomes clear, we don't have fanaticism. to any other opinion or any school of thought other than the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that is one of the means, yani, of bringing about unity, to abandon fanaticism to the opinions of people and, yani, the madahib, the schools of thought which is based upon ijtihad. Then another thing which will bring about unity amongst the Muslims, and this is a point of contention in our time, it is to restrict, and you're going to see why I said it's a point of contention, it is to restrict Hurriyat al-Ara, freedom of opinion and expression. This is something that is called to in our times. This is something that some of the modern scholars, they call towards freedom of opinion. And that every person should be free to express his views and to express his opinions. This cannot be correct in Islam. We say this is not Islamic. This may be democratic. You know, it may come from the demonocracy, you know, which they propagate, but this is not from Islam. Imagine everyone is free to express his own opinion. Whether you are qualified to express an opinion or not. Whether your opinion is against the Book of Allah and against the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not, you are free to express your opinion. Can you imagine the chaotic state that this ummah would be in if that was actualized? So that call is a call that must be, it must be, yani, must be restricted, and it must be put in its place and in its context. The person who is free to express his opinion is the person who is qualified to have an opinion. This is the first thing. The person who is free to express his opinion is the one who is qualified to have an opinion. Amatun Nas, the generality of people. Do the generality of people have the right to express their opinion with regards to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Huh? Do they?
No.
They don't. Amatun Nas, yani, those who are not talabatul ilm, not seekers of knowledge, have not studied the Qur'an and its meanings and its language and its tafsir and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and its sciences and its meanings. Do they have the right to just express their opinions in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. It is the scholar who is a mujtahid and is qualified to make ijtihad in the Book of Allah and in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam who has the right to express his opinion with regards to a mas'ala. Not everyone. This is the first thing. Only the people qualified to express their opinions and whose opinions are mu'tabara, whose opinions are considered. And what do we mean their opinions are considered? They are accepted by the ummah as the ulama of the ummah. You know my friend Archie here around the corner, if a mas'ala comes up, oh, the people are discussing fasting on the day of Saturday, and Archie comes and he says, you know what? Subhanallah, is this an opinion that is now to be conveyed to the Muslims of the Ummah, and that is now to be given weight and is considered? No. Because number one, the person is not qualified to give his opinion. He's not from the scholars, al-Mu'tabarun, who are looked at and who are returned to in the ummah for their opinions on the masail. So he's not qualified. The second point with regards to this is that any opinion which opposes the Book of Allah or the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have no right to express it. You don't have hurriyatul ra'i. You don't have freedom of expression and freedom of opinion, yani, with regards to that which opposes the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is established by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made this very clear. You know when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man kana yu'minu billahi wal yawm al-akhir, falyakul khayran aw liyasmut." Whoever believes in Allah in the last day, then let him speak good or keep quiet. So if your speech is not good, and how do we determine that which is good of speech? It must be in conformity with the Book of Allah and in conformity with the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is the speech which is good. It doesn't oppose the speech of Allah. It doesn't oppose the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, that is the speech that you may express. Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Whoever believes in Allah in the last day, let him speak good, or what? Or keep quiet." Or keep quiet. So if your opinion is not in conformity with the book and the sunnah, only yasmut. Keep quiet. Keep quiet is the best for you. You know, so there is no freedom of expression in Islam. This is something we must understand. There is no freedom of expression. Everyone can say whatever he wants. Imagine, subhanAllah, why did Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala send down the revelation of the Quran and the Sunnah? And why did Allah take upon himself to preserve and protect it? If we can just say whatever we want, and we can just have whatever opinion we want, and we are free to choose anything we want. So, a person is bound by the Sharia in the opinions which he expresses and that which he calls to. So that call of Huriyatu Ra'i, Yani wal Qawl, the freedom of expression and speech, this is something that must be restricted if we want to unite the Ummah. Because what does that bring about? It brings about more groups. It brings about more sects. More division. Because everyone who has an opinion is free to say it and is free to call other people towards it. Years ago, could you have imagined the open masjid, open mosque, remember this, you know this open mosque? Many years ago, could you have imagined there would be a masjid like that? No one would have imagined that there would be a masjid like that. Years ago, would you have imagined a woman's masjid where the imam is a woman and the khutbah, they are only women? This is found today. This is found today. They have a massive masjid. The woman's masjid. The imam is a lady, and only ladies give Jummah khutbah. And subhanAllah, everything. You know, and they give the answers and the fatwa in ladies' issues. SubhanAllah, poor men. I feel sorry for the men after this. But this is found today. Why? Because freedom of opinion and freedom of expression. We are free to do whatever we want. How's this masjid? Yeah, Claremont Main Road. Years ago, can you imagine in the masjid a lady's gonna come stand next to you? Dressed however she wants. SubhanAllah. Not hijab, a jeans and a long sweater. I'm covered. I'm covered. SubhanAllah. This is because of this false, this batil cause of freedom of opinion and freedom of expression. You know, and when you look, you'll find these people that are educated by the kuffar. Where do they learn deen? They learn deen at the Western universities. They learn deen at UCT. This is the reality. They learn deen at UCT, UWC, University of America. They get their PhDs. They get their PhDs from kuffar universities, but PhD in Islam. The PhD in Islamic studies taken from the universities of the kuffar. You know, Allah Akbar. And then, those are the people that promote, no, freedom of expression. Christmas lunch in the masjid.
Yes.
We must be realistic. This is real. This is happening. Where is this? Gatesville? open days, Christmas lunch, that Imam calls to everything. You can wish them Merry Christmas, you can sing Bani songs to the woman in the masjid. Subhanallah, freedom of expression. This is why there is no such thing in Islam. There is no such thing in Islam. If you are not qualified to give your opinion on matters of the deen, you must keep quiet. If the view that you hold is contrary to the book of Allah and the sunnah of Rasulullah, you must keep quiet for your own salvation and your own safety. Not for your own safety, because like Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you know, perhaps a man may utter a kalima, he may utter a statement or a word, la yulqi laha balan, and he pays no attention to it, but he will fall down into Jahannam for such and such distance on account of it. Freedom of expression. Utters a word, he thinks nothing of it. He thinks it's something small, but he will be thrown down into Jahannam for such and such a distance and such a depth on account of that word which he uttered. So when you know this, and also the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said to Mu'adh, kufa alayka hadha, hold on to this, and he took by his tongue. He said, hold on to this tightly. So what did Mu'adh say? Wa inna la mu'akhaduna bima natakallam. Ya Rasulullah, we're going to be punished for what we speak. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, taqilatka ummuk ya Mu'adh. Will your mother be bereft of you, O Mu'adh? وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسِ عَلَىٰ وُجُوهِهِمْ أَوْ عَلَىٰ مَنَاخِرِهِمْ فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. And what will drag people down on their faces or on their nostrils in the hellfire except that which their tongues have earned? So where is freedom of expression and freedom of speech? Not in Islam. And we'll never be able to unite the ummah whilst everyone can just say whatever he wants. How are we going to unite the ummah? You know, subhanallah. If fulan feels that the person that he is following is sent by Allah, he has the freedom to express this. Ahmadiyya. Believe in the Prophet other than after Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Mirza ul Ahmad, they believe in him. We say this is kufr, you have left the fold of al-Islam. You have left the fold of al-Islam. So if there's freedom of expression in them, no, they have the right to hold this view. They have the right to express it and they have the right to call to it. So it is a batil call, this freedom of expression and freedom of opinions. Then also, with regards to our interaction in the masail al-ijtihadiyya, because we often find that dissension is caused on account of masail which is ijtihadiyya. Splitting is caused on account of masail in which the ulama have made research and they have differed. So what is our, how do we interact with the likes of these things? If the mas'ala is a mas'ala ijtihadiyya and a person holds on to the view of a mujtahid, he holds on to the view of a mujtahid scholar and he has a strong proof for it. Sometimes we have ikhtilaf, as the ulama term it, ikhtilaf qawi. Ikhtilaf qawi. Very strong differing, because it's based on strong evidence. And one of the ways that this occurs sometimes is that both the parties that differ have the same dalil. Both have the same dalil and the dalil is authentic. Both base their opinion on a statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the same statement. But he understands it a different way that he understands it. So the ikhtilaf is qawi because he is a mujtahid, this is his understanding of the hadith. He is a mujtahid, this is his understanding of the hadith. So now what do we do with this ikhtilaf? Do we abandon one another? Do we enforce our opinion on others? No, we don't. And here, brothers, especially talabatul ilm, especially seekers of knowledge, they require a lot of patience. They require a lot of patience. Mas'alatul ikhtilafiyya comes up, and you have studied the mas'ala, and you have found that the strongest opinion for you is what Sheikh Fulan said. I'm going to make an example so that you all know the likes of what things we're talking about. Some of the ulama hold that when you come out of ruku' into i'tidal, you say Sami Allahu liman hamida, that you put your hands back on your chest. This is a view that some of the ulama, like Sheikh bin Baz rahimahullah ta'ala, and Sheikh Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, from the greatest mujtahideen of our time, and the two greatest fuqaha of our time, they held this view yani to be in accordance with the sunnah. And this is in accordance with the sunnah. Then comes the most learned specialist in the sunnah and hadith of our times and of the last century, Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, and he says, placing the hands back on the chest after ruku is a bid'ah and a dalalah. And these ulama, they are on the same aqidah, they are on the same manhaj, they are Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, and they mention the same ahadith. They mention the same hadith. So Sheikh bin Baz, they say, you know what, to return the limbs to the position it was before ruku, it means on your hands was on your chest before ruku, you put it back. Sheikh al-Albani says, no, this refers to the backbone. The limbs here refers to the bones moving back into their natural position, which is like you were in Qiyam, when you are standing up straight. This is the difference. So now we see from our brothers taking the one view, and some of the brothers taking the other view. We may hold that the strongest view is to put the hands down after ruku. Like Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala, and Sheikh Muqbil and other than them, from the Muhaddithun, the view that they held. Put the hands back, yani down in i'tidal. Some of the brothers, they say Sheikh Uthaymeen and Sheikh bin Baz, the argument in this, it is very strong, and the proof is the same proof. So I follow their understanding of this. So I put my hands back on my chest after the ruku. Are we now going to go to the brother and say, hey, you want bid'ah and balala? Huh? What are you doing? This is bid'ah, this is balala, this is misguidance that you're doing. No, subhanallah. Here comes tasamuh. Here comes being lenient and pardoning one another with this difference. You know, this is the same as we mentioned earlier with the issue of Banu Qurayza. How did Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam treat the Sahaba when their understanding differed? He didn't make inkar of any of them. He didn't reject the action of one of them because both acted on the same statement. Both groups acted on the same statement. Don't make Salatul Asr except in Banu Qurayza. Some said we must be there to make it. Others said he meant that we must be hasty. But when the time of Salah comes, we must make it. Right? So some made it on the way, and others they waited till they got into Banu Qurayza. And then when they came back to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and they said, this is what happened, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't reject what anyone did. And we both were correct. Because you acted on your understanding of what I said, and you acted on your understanding of what I said. Similarly with those two Sahaba, who were on a journey and yani, there was no water. There was no water. The two Sahaba that was on a journey and night betook them and they couldn't find the Qibla. And so they made ijtihad and they made salah in the direction that they were. And when it became light, it was clear to them that they didn't pray in the direction of the Qibla. So the one said, you know what, we prayed the salah and our salah is correct. And the other prayed the salah over. He prayed the salah over. And when they informed Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to the one who didn't pray over, asabta sunnah. You got the sunnah. And he said to the other one, lakal ajr marratain. You will get the reward twice. Because you prayed twice, and you only prayed once, but what you did is the sunnah, that is correct. But you also, you will get rewarded twice. And you didn't reject يعني, the understanding of either of them. So this is how we need to deal with this masail, which is ikhtilafiyya and ijtihadiyya, which is based upon research and in which the ulama differ. We need to have tasamuh, we need to forgive one another, we need to be patient with one another, we need to respect one another with regards to it. You know, and not fight with one another and be quick to label one another and to abandon one another on account of these matters. That is not the sunnah and that is not the way of the sahaba. So in such matters, yani we need to look at our interaction with regards to dealing with difference, dealing with ikhtilaf. Then also, from that which will bring about oneness and unity, and this goes back to what we mentioned earlier, husnul ta'amul, good interaction with one another through good akhlaq and good adab. This is to have husnul dhan for every Muslim. Husnul dhan for every Muslim. But you must have husnul dhan, good thoughts for every Muslim. And you must not hold suspicions. Hold suspicions and evil thoughts of the Muslims. One of the manifestations of this, and I've said this to brothers quite often, brothers pray, brothers live in an area where if there's a masjid, the imam who is not from Ahlul Sunnah. Maybe the imam is, you know, his methodology, he makes bid'ah, whatever the case may be, he has not been educated with regards to the Sunnah. And you find brothers saying, can we pray behind him? Can we pray behind him? Can I go to that masjid? As long as he is a Muslim, you must have husnul dhan for him. You must have a good thought of him. You must not harbor suspicions. Oh, you know what? He is not upon the sunnah. So I'm not going to pray there. Maybe he's making shirk. Allah, from not being upon the sunnah all the way to making shirk. You know, this is a big leap. So you must have husnul dhan for other Muslims. When this is why we say, whatever masjid you go into, you don't know the imam that is standing there, pray behind him. He's a Muslim. So you make salah behind him. This is one of the things which will bring together the ummah. This is one of the means of uniting the ummah. Because at the end of the day, if you're going to have suspicions of every imam that stands in front, you're not going to pray in any masjid. No, you're not going to pray in any masjid except in Portland and in Philippi and in Lavender Hills and in Plattekloof. So now there's only four masajid for you to pray in. Life is going to be very difficult. You will make life very difficult for yourself. A Muslim, when you come into an area and there's a masjid, you have husnul dhan of the Muslims. You have a good thought of the Muslims. That imam that is standing there is a Muslim. Alhamdulillah, you take it upon yourself, he knows the deen. You take it upon yourself, he worships Allah alone. Because this is the asal of every Muslim. This is the asal of every Muslim. So we must have husnul dhan for one another. One of the things which comes into play here is how we speak about the generality of Muslims. Many of us, when we speak about the Amatun Nas, and we know, you know, Fulan, he grew up making hadat on Thursday nights. Now I have learned that this Ratibul Haddad is not from Islam. This Ratibul Haddad is an innovation, it's a bid'ah. So now I say, you know what? Fulan is from Ahlul Bidah. Fulan is from Ahlul Bidah. This in itself is an accusation. This in itself is a very severe accusation. You know, this term, Ahlul Bidah, This is reserved for the innovators. This is reserved for the innovators. Then those who defend innovation and call to it. Not the generality of Muslims. If you're going to apply this to all the Muslims, who are you going to give da'wah to? Who are you going to give nasiha? Who are you going to call? Because there is consensus of the ulama that you must boycott the Ahlul Ahwa. The Ahlul Bidah must be boycotted. Ijma'ul ulama, there's consensus. So if all the Muslims that don't know what you know of the Sunnah is Ahlul Bidah, then you're going to boycott all the Muslims. How are you going to bring unity in the Ummah? How are you going to bring the Ummah together? How are you going to bring the Ummah to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So we must have husnul dhan bil muslimin. We must have good thoughts of the Muslims. We must have good ta'amul, good interactions with them. And only if there is a proof and there is certainty that the person, for example, is upon Shirk Akbar, then what is my duty? To advise him. My duty is to call him back. My duty is to give him the proofs from the Book of Allah and from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If he then rejects it and he remains upon that call, then you know, alhamdulillah, uqimat alayhi al-hujja, the proof has been established against him. This person is a mubtadi'. This person is a mubtadi'. So now you treat him as Ahlul Bidah. Not the Muslims, you treat as Ahlul Bidah. Many of our brothers, subhanAllah, this is something I've mentioned this many times. Do not address the generality of Muslims, do not address our brothers and sisters as Ahlul Bidah because they're making Bidah. Just like me and you, we were taught that that is our deen. Just like us. We were also taught that, we were also doing that, we also didn't know. And now that I know, I am Ahlul Sunnah and they're Ahlul Bidah. No, akhi, subhanAllah. Have mercy on the people. Have sabr with the people. Be kind towards the people. Love for them what you love for yourself. If you don't have this in you, that you love for your Muslim brother and sister what you love for yourself, you will never be a true caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because that guidance which Allah has guided you with, you must love for them to get it also. You must love for them to come upon the haqq. Some of the people when they speak is just, no, I established a proof against him, Sheikh. It's his own maqsad. Whenever he speaks to anyone, he just wants to establish the proof. It's like, right, I just want to just let him fill in the form so I can write him off. SubhanAllah, this is not our da'wah. It's not the da'wah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our da'wah is with kindness. Our da'wah is with yani leniency. Our da'wah is with gentleness. You know that we call the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the call of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the tawheed of Allah and the sunnah of his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to unite upon that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he makes us rightly guided guides. And that he subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us and guides others with us. And that he makes us a means to all those who are guided. And that he subhanahu wa ta'ala increases us in beneficial knowledge and in righteous actions. إِنَّهُ وَلِيُّ ذَلِكَ وَالْقَادِرُ عَلَيْهِ وَنَكْتَفِي بِهَذَا سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ